You've got the line left on your face. Now, make a wish. Oh, I didn't quite try again, sorry. Okay, what do you wish for? Tell the podcast.
I can't tell people what I wish for, then the wish wouldn't happen.
Well, it probably won't happen. So tell.
No, I hope it happens.
Just whisper it to me in the podcast. What was your wish?
I wish that the podcast got really famous and then all of the money went to me.
Well, that's definitely not going to happen.
Welcome to Myths.
I'm Matt Huss.
And I'm Dan Rhodes. Whether you know about Theseus or you're revising your syllabus,
if you want tales with a bit of jest or you just want to hear about incest.
What?
What? It's really interesting.
Welcome to Miss. Welcome to Miss.
Hello and welcome to episode 74 of the Miss Podcast. The podcast which we, it's handmade by us as well. We build it and we deliver it straight to your ears. That's what we do.
We do.
That's actually what we do, technically. How are you doing today, Dan?
Not too bad, Matt. How are you doing today, Matt?
I am very well. And I'm very rock and roll today, Dan.
Why is that, Matt?
Can you say it in a way which we haven't... Right, we have planned what we're going to talk about in this episode, and Dan has not... He hasn't shown that... He hasn't done his presenter's voice. Very much he's following the guidelines I've set for him. So let's try that.
So try again, sorry.
I'm feeling very rock and roll today, Dan.
Why? Did I know it?
I think you did, but let's try it one more time. Like, let's get have a bit more. I'll be like a voiceover director. Okay. Try and have a bit more.
Act like I didn't know this was happening.
Yeah, okay. Do that, and also pretend that there's a friendship here.
Okay.
I'm feeling pretty rock and roll today, Dan.
Oh, that's pretty cool. Can I ask why? I thought you always feel pretty rock and roll.
Oh, thanks, Dan. That was good. Nailed it. Do you think I'm quite rock and roll? Because I don't think people think I'm rock and roll.
Do I think you're rock and roll? Absolutely not. Do I think of you when I listen to rock and roll? Yes.
Oh, now that's actually a lot nicer. That's really good. But
no, it's not. Let me just clarify. What I'm saying is that are you a rock and roll cool kind of guy? No. But do you like rock music? And therefore, do I listen to rock and think, Matt probably likes this? Yes.
No, I think I prefer that because I'm not that person. That person who's like, I've got a neck tattoo and I like nipple piercings. You know what I mean?
Although you do have a neck tattoo and nipple piercings.
Oh yeah, but that's like part of the territory.
True, yeah.
That's how you get into rock gigs.
Yeah.
It's quite sweet that you think of me with rock songs because I like to be. Let's face it, I'm a music nerd, but not a music metal fan, if you know what I mean. So people get surprised when I mention, at the start of my Edinburgh show at the moment, I mention I go into a rock festival. I always go, oh, who thinks I'm rock and roll? Always silence. And it's a nice little moment between me and the audience. Mm. Come see me live from the 1st of August to the 25th of August at Edinburgh Fringe. Please buy tickets, only £5. At 10 past 7 at the Just The Tonic Meeting Room at the Grassmarket Centre. Quick plug! I went to see Metallica!
Nice!
Metallica's family!
Who'd you go with?
I went with my brother because it was my Christmas present.
Nice!
Guess how much tickets were?
Were they more than £60?
They were more than £60. Wow. It's very expensive.
£100.
£108.
Your brother paid £108 for
actually, my mum did, technically. It was my main Christmas present.
Oh, okay, that's nice.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I couldn't afford to go if I couldn't buy. I wouldn't spend that money myself.
Whereabouts was this show?
It was Manchester Etihad Stadium.
Manchester City.
Yes.
Nice.
Manchester. Didn't you see Musa?
No, I saw Musa at the Olympic Park.
30 Seconds to Mars.
At 02.
Oh, okay, cool, yeah. I liked Metallica. I thought the stadium was quite shit, to be honest, because basically the sound was all over the place for the gig. But
was it? Oh,
yeah. And Metallica have famously good sound, but it was terrible.
Acoustics.
It was just like they didn't plan it out properly. Mm-hmm. And you know how old I am now? Like I'm not rock and roll because I realise I complain at the sound at gigs. So that's who I am now. I'm not. When I was 15 years old, I was like, yeah, the fresh metal and like staring at boobs. But I'm not that person anymore because I realised that on the train there. Because on the train there, there's people also going to see Metallica. Metallica. They're wearing like these Metallica shirts, again, these neck tattoos, nipple piercings, drinking cans of lager on the train, stuff like that. But me, I was listening to an audiobook about a murder trial whilst drinking squash. I was like, I'm a different person. I'm not that person. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Was it packed, busy?
The gig, yeah, sold out, so nice. pretty nice. They also give you like disposable cups, or sort of, but recyclable cups, so basically you can hand them back and it's like a bit more green, but also Metallica themed as well.
Were you standing or sitting?
Standing.
Nice.
And
did you get a mosh pit?
Yes, I did. I got in quite a few mosh pits, but it was also properly raining, and I packed up everything as well.
Oh, was that raining too?
Proper
that
rain.
Couldn't have been nice.
Well, that's the thing, because this guy forgot his coat. Right, and I packed everything else, and so it's proper
slippery. By this guy, you mean yourself? Yes, so you're not talking about a guy in there.
Yeah, not talking to you, the listener. Like,
oh,
you forgot to bring my coat, you idiot. This guy. I thought it was more. When I said this guy, that's clear that I meant myself, right? Like, yeah. This guy, because although I'm pointing at myself, I think it sounds like I'm pointing at myself.
So, yeah.
This guy.
Yeah, let's see how long we can talk about this.
I think another 3 minutes on this. Solid goal.
This guy.
Sounds like you've just been an electric shock.
Yeah, because you didn't say, this guy forgot his coat.
Yeah, it's this guy.
Anyway, so you're in the rain and you haven't...
Yeah, and
you've forgotten something.
Yeah, and also, I got really pissed off at the gig, because I'm quite a small guy, and I don't really fare that well at gigs at the best of times, because I'm quite short, I can't barely see the stage. But the way they did it was that people at the sides were down, and the people in the middle were up, so it was really hard to see the stage, so I barely saw them as well. And you're paying a lot of money to see them, it's a very easy thing to fix. But so, on this sloped surface, it was raining, and there's a massive mosh pit as well, and it was really good fun. It was proper going around, and they dropped some absolute, proper stone-cold, stuff, obscure hits as well. They did Saint Anger, which is something they barely play, and I fucking loved that album. I was so happy. My brother didn't know any words, but I was like, yeah, it's playing the Saint Anger. But what had happened, Dan, is that during one of the songs, this has never happened to me before, and I've been to a lot of mosh pits, but I actually fell down in the mosh pit as well.
Oh no, got all rainy.
Yeah, I fell down, and I realised I was bleeding profusely from my arm. And it's healed over now, but...
Oh, it has, yeah. Yeah, it's got a scratch.
Yeah. Do you want to describe it to the listener?
It's about...
Dan's currently searching for something. I assume he's going to get a penny.
No, I want to get a ruler and find out how big it is.
And then we're going to find out how big
the
scab is.
In fact, I'll use this Moroccan dirham as...
Because you recently went to Morocco,
So if you're listeners, if you could just get your Moroccan dirham out... And then you'll be able to look at it and know what I'm talking about.
I like it because the listener's like, I've only just got my Mexican peso. Isn't I going to get a dirham as well?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. It is about...
Bear in mind, it has healed over a lot since.
It's about 3 serial numbers across.
And famously...
And about 4 deep.
Yeah, so famously... Moroccan dirhams, the serial numbers are 12 foot long.
So if you get your Moroccan dirham and look at the spacing of the serial numbers, you know exactly what I mean.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, it's not big.
It was a lot bigger, there's a gash as well, it's bleeding.
But I can see that it is very raw, very tender.
Yeah, and I can rest my arms on any tables. But it was painful, but... One of the most metal things that happened to me at the gig, that also, someone headbutted me by accident and hit me in the back of the head. Also, someone moved their arm back and hit me in the nose as well. So it's like, I really got a lot of wounds from the battlefront as well. But I think that's also quite fitting for a Metallica gig. And have you ever had experience where, you haven't been to many gigs, but that your experience at the gig resembled the kind of vibe of the performer?
Of the two gigs I've been to, no.
Because this is a very niche question, but... Like, my dad's a massive Bruce Springsteen fan, and Bruce Springsteen's he's like this kind of working class hero, and like he has lots of songs about love and romance, and there's quite theatrical kind of songs as well. And I went to see him went with my brother, my dad, and my dad's girlfriend at the time, and basically they all went together. And my dad and his girlfriend can be kind of, they can have moments of, theatrics and quite drama queeny as well. So, and at the gig, to cut long story short, my dad kind of ditched his girlfriend because the girlfriend got overwhelmed, went to the side, and he just stayed with me and my brother, and just like, nah, she sorted herself out. And then halfway through the gig, she's shouting at me, going, you left me over there, I was having I'm by myself, that's it, we're through, we're absolutely through, don't ever want to see you ever again. And she stormed out the gig, and my dad's like, oh, I'm going to have to go and find her, and stuff like that. And I think that's the most Bruce Springsteen thing that could ever happen to anyone at a gig. Like, the irony is so wonderful there, isn't it? That's a great story, I think.
That is a story.
I mean, it's not a funny one, but certainly a very good one. So I had a very Metallica experience as well, so, I also caught a pick as well.
Oh, they threw a pick in the... You gonna treasure that?
I did. Well, actually, my brother caught it, and he gifted it to me, and it said Manchester on it. Like, they did, Manchester had bees on it, and then personalised it as well for the day as well.
Oh, wow.
Because they were doing one in Manchester, one in London as well, so that's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
And also, I forgot as a teenager how much I loved Metallica as well, because I've been into Queen and a lot of Jeff Rosenstock recently. Hey, check out my Jeff Rosenstock blog on mathhousecomedy.com. Have you checked it out?
No. How many people have checked it out?
I haven't checked the analytics, but I think 12. And I have a fan base of about 2,000 people. So if you want to check that out, go on my website. It's called, it's under the blog, no one asked me to write this. And you can also follow my Queen blog there, which I think has a maximum of 50 people reading.
Isn't your Queen blog like 3,000 words?
3,500.
Oh my god.
And I send it to every girl I'm on a date as well. I was like, check, read this over. And I shouldn't mention this on the podcast, but the girl I'm dating at the moment called we'll bleep out her name. She said her favourite Queen song is Body Language. And have you ever listened to that song?
I have not.
It's the worst Queen song in the world.
And I was going to say, it's probably a reason I haven't heard of it.
It goes,
Body Language.
Body Language. But it's during that when Freddie really didn't care about doing Queen music, and he very much tried to do his own kind of like Berlin kind of pop music, and it was just kind of like, it was the worst. Should I play it quickly for you?
Yeah, please.
It's honest to God, it's...
Why haven't I heard of this? I feel like I've only heard of the good Queen songs. Was she just trying to impress you with her niche
No, because I hadn't even mentioned Queen yet, which it was like the two sentences in, so second message. But yeah, she...
What kind of music is she into?
A lot of pop stuff, so we shouldn't really talk about too much about, because I don't... Yeah, probably, let's not jinx it, please, and I don't want her to have a reason to not see me any further. So I'll play... Let's not talk about her anymore, but she does like... Yeah,
this person... And mentioned that they liked Body Language.
In the Queen blog, song. I mentioned that this is one... not their worst song, but one of the worst songs, I think. I think the worst song is I'm in Love with My Car, because that is, honest to God, the worst.
I have that song on my Spotify.
It's the worst...
It's so bad, it's good.
It's like, I told my girl I was going to forget her because I want to buy a new carburetor. It's like, just die in the bin, Roger Taylor. It's the worst thing I've ever heard in my life. Okay, are you ready for some Body Language? And I think, when I listen to Hot Space, because Hot Space is a weird album, because Hot Space, it's basically where Freddie wasn't part of the band. He's trying to do his own solo project. And, so this is what this is. It's like very Berlin. Obviously, we can't play the whole song for you on the podcast, but we can play a 30-second snippet.
Oh, this is not a good Queen song, is it?
Yeah, I'll stop it there.
It's not very listenable, is it?
Yeah, it's...
Compared to absolutely all the absolute fans.
It's such a weird song. Don't talk, don't talk, don't talk. By the language, yeah, it's a song.
I enjoyed that, actually.
Anyway, we should probably get onto the Myth. Are you going to listen to that song now?
No.
It's weird.
It's amazing that the band that wrote... Show Must Go On, Bohemian Rhapsody,
Radio Gaga,
Stop Me Now. Also wrote that.
But then again, they...
Every band has to have a few, but like, it's just how...
But I admire that they experimented with the form, you know what I mean? They pushed it out, and... But imagine trying to pitch that song to Brian May and Roger Taylor and John Deacon. Be like, guys, you got this cool song. Body Language. It's like... Because like, the rest of the album, Hot Space, half it's Freddie being like, this weird shit as well. The other half, it's like Roger Taylor and... Brian May just trying to make it a Queen album.
Make it rocky, yeah.
Because there's a couple of good songs on there. It's like Put Out the Fire as well. It's like it's a fine song. It's fine. It's like a classic Queen. But yeah,
who's put that sound on like?
Yeah, do you want
to just for the purposes of right now?
Put out the fire.
They have so many songs, don't they?
Well, check out my Queen blog. It's actually a really good song.
That's not a bad song, I like it. That's Queenie, isn't it? Mm. It's a good old voice, isn't it?
Yeah, Freddie Mercury is a fine voice. Yeah, he's okay. A good singer. Yeah, not as good as me. Alright.
Shall we crack up with a myth?
That's a nice detail, wasn't it?
It was.
Anyway, it's time to do some myths.
Hey there, my name's Matt Huss, and in this link I have an American accent, and I advocate the safe use of myths podcasts. In small doses.
Okay, Dan, we are currently this is the fourth episode on the Aeneid, three episodes down. What has happened so far?
A man.
Yes, and that's all we're caught up.
Called Aeneas. He arrived at a place.
Why are you doing it in like a high queue?
I can't remember what the place is called.
Carthage.
He arrived at Carthage.
How are you pointing at me when you need assistance?
He arrived at
Carthage.
And he was met there by Queen
Dido.
Who he fell in
love with. Nice.
He fell in love with. She's then like, wow, you got shipwrecked here on our land of Carthage. How did you get here? And he's like, well, took me 7 years. Do you want to hear the whole story? And she's like, yeah, but can you condense it into one book, please, an easily manageable episode? And he said, yeah.
Yeah.
Episode 73 of Myths.
Yeah.
In which he basically did the journey that Odysseus does.
Well, in that...
From Troy. He's escaping Troy. Yeah, Turns out he's from Troy.
Yeah, we see the siege in Troy, and then we also see him escape Troy, and also the adventure book.
We saw Troy, but from a Trojan side of view.
Sorry, Queen came back on.
Yeah, he escaped Troy with his men and his family and ended up on this crazy adventure through various islands, and he met cyclopses and flying harpies that are like half woman, half bird, talking plants.
Yeah.
Yeah, various places. But now he's arrived back.
Yeah.
So, and he's just filled everyone in how he got back to Carthage.
So we're back in Carthage, we're currently at the feast. And just to clarify on the point that Dan made, Aeneas has feelings for Dido, but they're not quite... Yeah, he hasn't solidified them
yet. She's in love with him, because Cupid shot him with an arrow.
Yes, do you know why that happened?
No, I can't remember.
So what happened, that Aeneas' mum, Venus, because Carthage is Juno's city, and Juno hates Aeneas, so what Venus does is that she sends her other son, Cupid, to hit Dido with the love arrow to make her fall in love with Aeneas to make that journey easy. To basically get to Dido before Dido is affected by Juno.
Okay, yeah.
She's playing like chess, if you know what I mean. Yeah. However, so this is going to come out and play. So, this is book four of the Aeneid, and we just had a lovely feast. So, Dido's love for Aeneas, described as a wound and as a flame, grows as she listens to Aeneas' sad story. She eventually works up the nerve to speak to her sister, Anna, describing her alarm at her passion for Aeneas and how she had never loved anyone other than Sychaeus.
I love that she's got a really normal sister's name.
Yeah, it's like, Dido, Sychaeus, and Anna. So do you remember who Sychaeus was?
No.
Do you want me to explain that?
Yes.
So Dido was also queen of a place called Tyre, and basically, I believe, an evil guy called Pygmalion kind of killed Sychaeus, the king of Tyre, and basically she fled there because of Pygmalion, and she found in Carthage.
Nice.
She's obviously going through so much emotions at the moment because she's fallen in love with this random guy. She also feels bad for her husband as well, because Aeneas moved on quite quickly after Creusa. It's like, alright, see ya, bye. But with her, she's like, I don't know. But she's talking to her sister about it all, and she's going... Obviously, this divine intervention is quite important because she shouldn't naturally be feeling like this. But let's see. I feel quite bad for Dido at this moment. But so weeping, she states that she'd rather die than betray Sychaeus' memory. Anna encourages Dido to let herself love. Anna argues that a marriage with Aeneas makes emotional sense, since Dido won't waste her youth in loneliness, and tactical sense, since Carthage is surrounded by enemies, including King Iarbas of a nearby nation, whose love Dido has spurned, and could use an alliance like this. So, emotionally, she feels connected to them, so she did it. Also, tactically, if she matched up with the Trojans, she,
it's a good alias.
Yeah, but it's like, bear in mind, King. Yes, but bear in mind King Iarbas, because he's going to be quite important in a second. Anna encourages Dido to keep Aeneas in Carthage by warning him of the dangers of sailing in winter storms. Dido's doubts easily vanish as she gives her into her passion. Which is nice, isn't it?
Nice, yeah.
Because we don't really see nice moments in these myths that much. Virgil compares poor Dido to a doe who doesn't realise that that a hunter's arrow is still stuck in her side. Dido makes sure that Aeneas sees how wealthy she is, yet, love-struck, she can hardly bring herself to speak with him. She treasures his every word, and stays up at night, lingering alone where he sat at dinner. Without her guidance, construction of Carthage comes to a halt.
So she's so in love and love-struck by Cupid's arrow that she's like, not even, she's just in a daze.
Yes!
Oh, I'm so in love,
Well, that's Dido's voice. Yeah. Oh, hello, I'm a lady. Yeah. But yeah, she in the first one we see Carthage like a hive where bees are building up this like central hub. But now with the construction stopped, she's got dick on the brain.
Okay, yep.
But she also sounds very Matt Hoss there, like lingering alone at night where the person sat for dinner, just treasuring everyone's word. That's a Matt Hoss move.
Nice. That is actually.
Yeah. That's depressing, isn't it? Anyway, Juno angrily addresses Venus for putting Dido in such a state, hoping to protect Carthage and block Aeneas' fate. Juno asks to solidify a balanced union by getting Aeneas and Dido married.
Nice.
So, yeah, so...
she's going to be right up for that, Dido.
Yeah, well, because... Why would Juno be up for this as well?
Well, I don't know. I thought Juno wouldn't want this.
Well, actually, because she loves Carthage. Carthage is her city. And even though she knows fate of Aeneas, if she's able to create them, if she's able to keep Aeneas there, he won't go on to find Rome and it won't
get
destroyed.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So it works for a lot in her favour, actually.
Yeah, if she keeps him in Carthage, yeah. He can't go anywhere.
Okay. So a marriage is actually quite important to this. Venus feigns agreement to this, saying that this merger of Carthage and Troy must be fate, but she is she knows it's not really true. So it's kind of god politics happening here.
Yeah.
And we don't really see that much god politics, but this is very much a lot of the Aeneas to do with this as well. Juno explains the wedding plans to Venus. Now, bear in mind, they're saying wedding plans, but I want to hear your thoughts on this afterwards. So, when Aeneas and Dido join a hunting group tomorrow, Juno will create a huge storm. The couple will take refuge in a cave, where Juno will marry them. Venus again pretends to agree, but has secret other plans. The following day, the hunting party sets out, including the majestically dressed Dido and Aeneas, who is so handsome he resembles Apollo. The storm arrives, scattering the groups, and Aeneas and Dido end up together in a cave as planned. Juno presides over the wedding, with nature as a witness, while the nymphs cry from the hills. Now, this is the point we have to discuss, because Virgil doesn't mention if the couple physically consummates the marriage, but he hints that they do, writing that Dido calls it marriage, using the words to cloak her sense of guilt. However, now this is important, because if you read the epic, it just sounds like they've banged in a cave. That's essentially what's just happened. They've pounded at it.
It's raining. Yeah. They've got lost from the hunting party. They've gone into a cave, and done what adults do.
They play Scrabble and talk about their feelings.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, my mum used to call having sex playing Scrabble.
Nice.
But she wouldn't want to play Scrabble with the family. That's too weird. But yeah, so I don't think Aeneas knows that he's married, because from his perspective, he's just banged.
He just banged to go in a cave.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then, did he not question why God was in there doing a marriage?
But again, I think Juno's gone like, and now you're married. Like, she hasn't come down and performed the ceremony.
Just said it from up in.
Yeah, Olympus. Yeah. There's no ceremony. They just literally just fucked in the cave.
Nice.
Would you ever fuck in a cave? Would you ever have a wedding in a cave?
Yes, a wedding in a cave would be pretty cool.
You know, we went to the salt mines in in
Krakow.
I was gonna say Croatia, but Poland. Yeah, and would you ever get married down there?
Because that was pretty cool. Yeah, they do marriages. That was pretty cool. All the Waitomo K's in New Zealand. People know what that is.
Yep, everyone does. So yeah,
where the glowworms live.
So Dido says it's a marriage, but I think she's trying to cover her guilt for just. She feels bad for Sakaeus, but also means...
She feels bad that she's just married these people without them realising their marriage.
Also...
Dido must have been having a great time, by the way. She's, like, finally managed to sleep with the boy that she's in love with.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's see what happens. Do I take it from here?
I'll do my normal podcast voice.
Yeah, please. Thank you.
Meanwhile, rumour, the swiftest of all the... Meanwhile...
Eat dreams, all dreams.
Hello, Simba. Meanwhile, rumour, the swiftest of all the evils in the world, that famous thing, spreads gossip about Dido and Aeneas' shameful union around the entire region and about how they've forgotten their leadership roles, shirked their duties, and have spent the whole winter together. Mm. It's not their fault, they didn't even know they were... Yeah. Iarbas, the nearby king, whose love Dido spurned, hears the rumours and, jealous, appeals to his father Jupiter to intervene. Is Jupiter everyone's dad?
Yeah, obviously he's everyone's dad.
Iarbas criticises Aeneas for becoming like a woman, perfuming himself and letting his men become eunuchs. Good God.
Basically, Iarbas is like a Twitter troll. He's very much like an alt-right, like, oh, you cook. Oh my God, you're such a...
Why are they eunuchs, though? Why has his men become eunuchs?
Well, no, basically I think it means that they...
He's implying that they may as well...
Yeah, well, it's like, oh, he's so effeminate. They're all so effeminate, they're eunuchs now.
Sexist, isn't it, really?
Yeah, well, I think Iarbas, you know, has a lot of homophobic and sexist tendencies, and he should really check those out. You know, check your privilege, mate.
After checking on the situation in Carthage, Jupiter sends Mercury to remind Aeneas of his mission. Mercury flies with his winged sandals to Carthage.
Okay, before we go any further, I think let's take this all in, because Rumour, this like evil thing, has...
They're banged in a cave, got married, don't know they're married, though.
The god Rumour goes like, hey, have you heard about all this thing? And he goes around and spreads it around. What Virgil does really well, he kind of manifests like these things like rumours as like physical things. He does that. He paints a really lovely picture as well. But so there's a lot of personifications in this as well. And Iarbas gets it. He's like, Dad, can you get them to stop doing it, please?
He's jealous.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, and he's like, okay, fair enough.
So Jupiter's got Mercury.
Yes, and Mercury comes down. But yeah, this is
Mercury. Of course, is Hermes. Yes, in the Greek.
The winged messenger. And we're going to... This is a lot to talk about here, so go ahead, Dan.
Mercury finds Aeneas bedecked in sumptuous clothing embroidered by Dido with an ornamental sword. Mercury asks him why he lingers here, neglecting his own future kingdom. If Aeneas doesn't care to leave, he should at least think of Ascanius, a promising future king and forefather of the Romans. That's his son, right? Mercury disappears. Aeneas is so dumbstruck and frightened that his hair stands on end. Because a god has just appeared and been like, what are you doing? And he's like, think about your son. Bye.
Well,
that would be weird if that happened.
I think this is a good talking point here, because Aeneas is really, I think he's genuinely quite happy to be with Dido at this moment. He wants to stay there. He wants to build this place. He loves Carthage, and he's building this place and a home for the first time. You know, this is the first time he's landed for 7 years. And he found his place. However, and then someone goes up to you, no, you can't stay here, you have to go. And he goes, I don't really want to. What if I want to stay here? He goes, well, if you don't go, you're denying him fate and destiny and stuff like that.
That's a big deal back then.
Yeah, and absolutely. And he's like, and he's such a pious guy. So when a god comes down to tell you you have to do it, it's like, oh, I guess I have to go. But I find I think that's a very fascinating thing though, right? Like, he's caught between his pious duty to do his thing and his fate
and his love,
and yeah, what do you choose? It's like, do I choose my star of like being a star of comedy and off screen, or do I choose wanking for the flannel? Which one do I choose?
It's difficult, isn't it?
It's a daily choice.
Aeneas struggles to decide how to break the news of his departure to Dido. He decides to prepare to leave in secret and figure out how to tell her later. His men are happy to depart. Okay. It's always the best way to go about things.
Also, like, there's a lot of, like, this is where... Well, I was just saying how nice Aeneas was to have that kind of moment. But now he's like, you know what? I'm going to ghost her, and then I'll figure out how to tell her after.
I'm gone, I'll send a messenger or something.
How can you do that, though? You can't just, like... You're gone, then. You know what I mean? What a...
When Dido hears rumours that Aeneas is leaving, she comes to him in rage. railing against him for planning to leave in secret and for breaking apart their recent marriage, yeah, which happened like a day ago, asking if he really must depart during the winter, and begged for his pity.
Okay, but that's but this is the thing, because in the book, they mention, like, she mentions, oh, we've been married, you're shaking off this marriage, and he's like, no, we're not married, and like, there's that awkward moment, it's like, what, you thought we were married?
Oh, he finds out they're married.
Yeah. I'll just, if you want to keep on reading, and I'll find a moment for you, and so. Oh, wait, also, do you want to hear about how Iobus was consummated?
Oh, yeah.
Jupiter had ravished a Garamantian nymph, and Iobus was his son. There you go.
Nice. So, that's not like Zeus / Jupiter to rape someone.
Well, I said ravish, but it does imply that, doesn't it?
So she's begging him for pity and to stay. She's disgraced herself, she says, and adds that if he leaves, she will end up either married to Iobus or conquered by Pygmalion. She would at least be happy if they'd had a child together, a little Aeneas to keep her company.
Yeah, but again, she's quite keen there. You know, mm-hmm. Then again, divine intervention has caused that, but she's very much like, well, I know I've only been on two dates, but I want a little kid, please.
Aeneas is sorry, but he suppresses his emotions, and he remembers Jupiter's orders. He tells Dido that she should not have thought they were married, as he never discussed being her husband, and they never had a ceremony. If he could have controlled his fate, he says, he would still be in Troy. But since his fate calls him to Italy, he must go. He explains that Mercury came to remind him. Aeneas must go against his will.
So what's
And she's like, he's like, shut up, bitch, we're not married. We banged in a cave.
In all fairness, I think he's more like, I'm really sorry. And
I didn't know we'd get married. Yeah. I wouldn't have done it if I knew. Yeah.
But then again, he's not, I don't think he's that tactful, though, you know what I mean? Like, first, he would have gone to, hey, look, X, Y, Z. I think that she's more pissed off at him because she didn't tell him as well.
Yeah.
Like, if he had a chance to explain it. But that's why this is spiraling out of control. And what we see here is that we have, like, Homeric responses here. So, Dido will have, like a paragraph where she gets across her point. Then Aeneas will... It goes back to Dido and back to Aeneas as well.
Nice.
So what does Aeneas say... what does Dido say as a retort? Dido
insults Aeneas, saying that he's not a goddess's son, but was instead born from the earth and nursed by tigers.
What a sick burn.
What a...
You're nursed by tigers,
motherfucker. How is that an insult?
That's pretty cool.
You ain't no demigod. You were just born of the earth miraculously and raised by tigers. That's not cool. And he'll be like, mate, that's way cooler.
I wish my mum was a tiger.
She describes her misery in a monologue, which Matt is now going to perform. No.
How she welcome to my Edinburgh Fringe show.
How she welcomed him as a stranger and split her kingdom with him, only to be spurned. Which she did spurn Iobus, to be fair. Yeah. How she won't try to change the decision, but her ghost will haunt him. And we know ghosts exist in this universe because we've seen a few of them. Dido leaves, fainting. And though Aeneas has many things to say to her, he piously goes to his ships. The Trojans quickly prepare to exit the city, resembling ants that scurry away with a pile of grain. It takes them a day to get ready to leave.
Oh, that's awkward, having to kind of leave, but it's taking a day as well. Also, how is he trying to sneak off as well? It's going to take a whole day, and you're going to think you're just going to get the by notice as well.
Oh, God, I know. What happens, Matt?
Okay, just before we leave,
Before we leave? What are you on about?
Before they leave, there's a... I've brought down my Aeneid book down to Wimbledon just to, because there's one line in here, which, like, basically, Virgil very rarely shows his own emotions here, but he puts in this line here, which is, it shows his own, like, and it's quite sexist, but I want to read it out. Come then, no more delay. Women are unstable creatures, always changing. It's like, alright, mate, come for a bad breakup. That's because like there's no need for to write that, and it's not part of the story. It's like it's literally just Virgil just writing that as well. It's like not no characters are saying that as well.
It's quite funny.
Both Iarbus and Virgil like Twitter trolls. So, meanwhile, Dido asks Anna to hurry to the shore and ask Aeneas to remain in Carthage until the winter ends and better sailing weather arrives. Which is actually makes
very
sense.
Sensible, yeah.
And there's no rush to leave right now as well, right?
Like, no, I mean, there kind of is because they've just had a really awkward conversation.
Yeah, now there is, but you could have waited like a couple of months, yeah. You know what I mean? And broke it to her nicely. Anna attempts to convince Aeneas, but the fates and the heavens block Aeneas' ears so he won't change his mind. Like
that old trick.
Yeah. Just stick some wax in, mate, yeah. he got baby bells in his ears.
Basically, what's happened is she's like, "You can't leave," and he's like, "I can't hear you, I can't hear you. The gods are making me not hear you."
Because Aeneas, what was quite a charming man, is now quite like
petulant,
puerile as well. Virgil compares Aeneas to a mighty tree with a crown that reaches the sky and roots that stretch to the underworld. So he's like an oak tree that's unmovable, but also has no emotional availability as well. Dido prays for death. As she prays at her shrine, the water turns black and the wine turns to blood. She interprets these signs as encouraging her suicidal plans, but says nothing to Anna.
I think I would also read those as signs if all of the water around me turned black and the wine I was drinking became blood. I would start to think, might be a sign here. Not necessarily suicide, but definitely something's going on.
Yeah, I mean, that's not a normal day at the office, is it? Like, imagine hanging out at the water cooler.
Also, but she says nothing to her sister, so she's just like keeping that quiet that that happened.
Yeah, she's very much like
traumatized.
She's like, yeah, I'm totally fine. It's fine. Just
nothing creepy happened yesterday.
Yeah, yeah, and she's very much. I think she doesn't want to worry her sister because her sister will talk her out of it.
Yeah.
There's also like this is really nerdy now, but I think in the original first draft of this, I think that Dido was meant to is the Queen of Carthage, but Aeneas falls in love with Anna.
Oh, nice.
Don't know why. Change, but it happened. Night falls and the Trojans sleep in their ships, not welcome in the city, planning to leave the next day. Dido endures nightmares about Aeneas. Dido prepares for her death, hiding her intentions from Anna, pretending to be happy. She tells Anna that a priestess recommended ending her heartbreak by burning Aeneas' clothes and armour on a pyre. That's very long for a set there. It's like, it'd be really good if we got a funeral pyre and just kind of like burnt all the stuff. And I was like, yeah, you go, girl. I'll set that up for you.
Yeah.
Why don't you write a country album like I did? Good way to get over a heartbreak. Or talk about it on the podcast profusely.
Or write an Edinburgh Fringe show about it.
Yep. All of the above is fine.
You're fine.
Yeah. I'm actually really happy now. Because I'm dating a girl that listens to body language. No, but just find yourself. You don't need to kill yourself. It's fine. Not worth it. Aeneas is definitely not worth it. He's just a little prick, if anything. You know what I mean? So Anna prepares the pyre, and Dido decorates it, and prays throughout the night. Once more, she ponders her future, seeing no escape from her sadness. Even if she went with the Trojans, she'd be nothing more than a scorned servant, and she'd rather die than try to fight them in a war. So, she could have went with him as well, but then again, Aeneas didn't really open up that line of conversation. But then again, we didn't have the option to, I guess. So, during the night, Mercury again appears to Aeneas, telling him to leave quickly before the Carthaginians come to attack their ships. Aeneas wakes his men, and the Trojans set sail, leaving the Carthaginian shore.
So, they've gone. Boom. He's left.
Yeah, because, he didn't want them to turn sour as well. At dawn, Dido sees the ships have sailed away. Crazy with heartbreak, and she wishes she had killed Aeneas, and when she had the chance, she prays that he will have to fight and watch his people die before founding his city, and asks that he die before reaching old age. She proclaims that her descendants will be the eternal enemies of his. So again, that's setting up like a contemporary Roman thing, where Carthaginians will battle that. It's also that, it's weird, because their fate it's destined that Rome will fight Carthage in the future, but also they created that destiny. Do you know what I mean?
Yes,
yeah. Because they were fighting fate, they also caused it to happen.
Mm.
Weird, isn't it? Then, while the nurse is away, she climbs the pyre and gives a final speech. She says she's glad to have built a beautiful city and to have avenged her Sychaeus and wishes that the Trojans had never come. She will die without ever having gotten revenge on Aeneas, but hopes he's sorry to hear of her death. She finally gets a massive sword and stabs herself through her stomach. Anna runs to the still dying Dido's side, distraught that Dido had concealed her suicidal plans and gotten Anna to build the pyre under false pretenses. Anna climbs the pyre and holds her dying sister. Juno sends Iris to end Dido's slow torment. Iris offers Dido's body to the underworld, cuts her hair, and ends her life. That's the end of book four.
What a sad ending.
Didn't expect it to go that way, did you?
No, she's dead.
Yeah, but I think, honestly, that's quite an innovative story. It's a lot of human emotions going on there. Also, but very relatable, but also nothing really happens like that in most of the Greeks.
Very human.
Yeah. A lot going on there, and I think we're going to have a lot of time, a good time, like, ranking it as well. So, should we go and do that?
Nah.
Okay, yeah, let's just end the podcast. Let's go for it.
Myths.
Okay, man, how did you feel about that? As everyone knows, we rank this in four categories, each category out of 10, making a total out of 40. The first category we're going to discuss today is life skills.
Before we do that, we have actually got a new jingle. I want to play it for you now.
Oh, have we? Okay, nice. Oh, we love my car.
As I'm in love with my car. Let's just wait for the chorus.
Worst song in the world. Well, here's the gear, that's not very good.
I'm in love with my cat.
It's not the worst song.
It is. Well, I think it is a what's worse, that or Body Language?
Body Language.
Body Language. It's a weird. Body Language catches you off guard. That's at least a Queen song, you know what I mean? But again, I still think it's worse. Anyway, yes, we rank it in four categories. To be honest, I think this is one of my favourite. I think this is actually one of my favourite moments of the whole of the Aeneid, actually, because it's such a ripe moment, and I think it's such an interesting one as well, because that relationship between Aeneas and Dido, the course of it, how it happens, where there's genuine confusion, and there's a divine intervention to make it worse, there's so much going on there. I think it's such one of the best moments of, like, over the whole mess, is one of my favourite moments, actually, and quite a sad one as well. Did you like it?
I did like it, yes.
So let's talk about life skills. What practical things have we learned here?
How to kill yourself?
Yep, we learned how to hide your suicidal plans.
How to hide your suicidal plans. No, which, by the way, not a good thing to do.
No, shit. Honestly, like, if you're feeling down or want to chat to something, either talk to a friend about it, or Samaritans are always there, and, like, always very helpful as well.
Did they hug up on you one time?
Samaritans have hung up on me as well, like, and that story's too sad for my current show.
Yeah.
No, it was actually quite a funny story. Quite a funny story. And, yeah, good times. Something you probably shouldn't repeat. But, yeah, I've got Samaritans before, but not as a suicidal thing, more as just I was a bit sad and then wanted to chat to someone, and they're very good. Although, I do ask, I was like, can you help me out? I was like, talking to a man called Brian, who hung up on me. What? Brian's a cunt. So.
Nice. Last year, we learned how to build a funeral pyre.
Yes.
We learned how to get married. Yes. In a cave.
Well, also, we learned how to bang in a cave.
We learned how to bang in a cave. Oh, we learned how to stop squirting water everywhere.
Because I got a very squirty bottle. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
How to hunt in the rain. How to create a storm.
Yes.
How to send a messenger.
How to make false plans with the gods.
How to make false plans with the gods.
How to get your own back, you know, like, get over that girl by, like, kind of, like, building your own funeral pyre and setting fire to his clothes and stuff like that. That's so Alanis Morissette, I love that. We also learned fate and stuff like that. We also learned how to get someone to go and leave and stuff like that. We also learned how to break up with someone, like, by ghosting them in the night. Aeneas is a regional ghoster, isn't he?
He is, yes. That's kind of harsh, actually, bless him.
We also learned that having sex with him doesn't constitute as... marriage.
Yep.
We also learned that Virgil's misogynistic. Oh, also learned how to ravage Garamantian nymph.
I was about to say, actually, we learned how to rape someone.
Stop saying that!
It's implied when they said ravaged.
Yeah, but, yeah, you're right. It's so grim, though, huh? But also we learned how to, like, get your dad to sort out all your problems.
Yep. I've already got a number in my head.
What is it?
Probably an 8, actually.
Do you think it's more than last time?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't think it's as much. Also learned how to stop the production of a city.
Yeah, we've got loads of different stuff. Lots of different types of skills.
I don't think it's as...
7.
Yeah, okay with 7?
Yeah.
For all of this ones, I want you to suggest a number and I will say...
Which one is right or wrong?
Yeah, yeah.
Morals. These are ethical things we've learned.
Oh.
Or ethical themes, perhaps, that happened.
Yeah, also, don't kill yourself over... Footboy, you're better than that.
Don't please tell someone if you're marrying them.
Yes, good to know, isn't it?
It's good, yeah. Nice to get a heads up sometimes.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, Dan and I are married. He didn't know that, but we didn't sleep in the same bed last night, so...
Well, that is how it works.
And also, whilst you were sleeping, I put an engagement ring on my finger going, yes, I do.
And then you put an engagement ring on my finger as I slept. That was creepy.
Yep.
what else... God, what else moral things have we learned?
What else? I guess... I think there's actually huge morals here. Like,
don't mess someone up. Like, trying to mastermind someone's relationship for your own gain, Juno.
But it was actually... I think Venus is worse for it as well.
Venus?
Because Juno accepted it, and she was actually quite chilled out, because usually she's not like that. But then Venus... But this is why I think it's interesting, and morals are quite high in this, because... The gods, the gods killed Dido for their own gain. They don't care about human life, but they care about Aeneas' life. So his life is more important than hers. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And she's just a pawn in their game, and the gods are so lying and deceitful. And I think we don't really see this before, how it impacts their human life so much, apart from, like, the obvious stuff. But, like, so I think this is such a nuanced version of this as well. Is it okay for the gods to do that as well? And it's only because the gods intervened that this happened as well. So, yeah, I don't know. And she probably wouldn't have acted so rageful if she hadn't been hit by Cupid's arrow, if you know what I mean. But that being said, also, don't leave someone in the middle of the night. Don't ghost them. Also, if you are leaving someone, probably be a bit more tactful and stuff like that. And listen to reason, I would say. But I think that's quite hard. I think it's a high one. It's very human emotions, this one. You say your number, and I'll say if I agree with it or not.
6.
No. I think it's higher. I was thinking 9, genuinely.
9? Nah, there's no way it's a 9.
Well, I think it's like big themes here, man. Big themes. Also saying she feels guilty about her husband as well at the start of it.
I suppose there was a lot of dark themes.
A lot of gods getting in with it as well. It's a mixture of human and gods politics as well. And love and business and fate as well.
Yeah, and she's obviously sad. And the whole suicide and stuff.
But yeah, I think this is...
What about 8?
Can I push you to a 9? Because I think it's pretty good.
Oh, alright, go on then. I did zone out halfway through you talking about it, so I'll give you that.
All I love is, like, you don't even put up a fight anymore. What you do is just go, I just want this podcast for you.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what I say, you're going to overrule me.
No, I'm not. I want to hear...
Creativity.
Let's go back. Like, if you think it's an 8, fight for it. Tell me why.
Well, I can't remember why I thought it was an 8. I honestly can't remember. I don't think there was a big enough moral, like, other than her, like, wanting to kill herself. That's a bit sad. And then puppeteering someone's love. That's it.
No, I think it's more than that, though. I think, I did talk quite extensively about it, but I think the gods and the... Basically, it's how not to break up with someone and also the ramifications of the gods affecting human lives.
Fine, that's a good one. Creativity. This is quite creative.
We are a married couple.
It's quite creative, though. I'll give it that.
Yeah, take me for it.
It's creative, Matt, because there was the gods engineering the love. There was him not even knowing that he's married. That's pretty creative.
Yeah, and
how they even got them married was pretty creative in the cave and whatnot. Her deceiving Anna, her sister, making her build this pyre, knowing that full well she was going to stab herself and throw herself on it.
Yeah.
What's his face just leaving and being a total asswipe about it?
Yes, and also...
How are you going to tell your wife that you're leaving? I'll do it after I left.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And also, like, how this genuine... What we've never seen before is, like misunderstanding from both parties. Not a major one, but, like, how she interprets marriage and also how he interpreted the Crave moment as well. So I think that's... so I think that's genuine. We don't see that... I've never seen that texture before as well. I think that's really cool. And also, like, yeah, I think the gods... We have gods in here, and there's no monsters, but what we do have is something... We haven't seen any of this before.
No, I think it's very human.
Yeah, it's the most human one we've seen, I think. and it's sad, but I think it's very, it's like a Greek tragedy, you know what I mean? And also someone like Iarbas and the nymph as well, stuff like that.
No, that was pretty, like, the narrative of Iarbas and even having him as another character.
Also, having, like, their love affect the city as well, and it stops production and it stops fate as well.
Yeah.
And that's quite an all comes
in. Actually, I've just realised that Iarbas is actually why I also forgot about him in the morals aspect. That was quite good.
Yeah.
Because he was like...
So are you warming up to a 9?
He was like being jealous. Okay, yeah. I'm increasingly happier with the 9.
Okay.
Creativity, though. Not as creative as other ones, though, let's be honest.
Well, last time we gave 9 to episode 73.
No, that's a lot happened. It was a huge journey and monsters and gods and different characters, death...
But also we had to exposition. Well, we did have death. The only thing it's missing is monsters. But
it's an 8.
Or is it a 9? Because there's a lot going on, Dan.
There is a lot going on. And there is a narrative, but it doesn't... The narrative isn't...
I think it's quite a strong narrative, which we haven't seen before. But also, the only thing it's missing is monsters. And I think that's the stock thing.
That's why it's an 8.
But that's why it's not a 10, though.
Nah, it's not a 10 because I don't think there was enough, like...
But there's a hunting party, there's a cave sex. Cave sex, Dan!
It's not a 10.
Suicide!
Because it didn't have a big enough narrative for me in terms of, like, the wider picture, as of right now.
Oh, but also, in terms of creativity, they're linking... Virgil links this to modern-day Carthage, though, you know what I mean? Like, I think that's why they've had wars, that's fate and destiny and stuff like that.
Was that mentioned?
Yeah, because she puts a curse on them, She says, "Oh, I hope I rule you. I hope you get killed before you get to Lavinium, and also I hope that your descendants will fight my descendants one day."
Did she say that?
Yeah. Let me find it for you.
I don't remember that.
Yeah. Well, you probably zoned out whilst I said it to you. She proclaims that her descendants will be eternal enemies of his.
Okay, so there is like some backstory. Okay, you just called me out, my. Because that's normally what we like to see in creativity. I like to see, like, the wider narrative. But, the House of Pelops, the kind of thing.
But this is a wider narrative, I think, though. It's kind of giving a backstory to the war in between Rome and Carthage.
Mm.
You still thinking 8?
I am, yeah. I don't know what it was about this myth. I just didn't enjoy it as much as last week.
But it's not about enjoyment, it's about creativity.
I know, but creativity is enjoyment.
I think it's on par with last week's, I think.
But you are, yeah, I wouldn't say it was any...
It's missing monsters.
It's missing monsters.
But then again,
but it did have sex and death.
Sex and death, which is more than it had beforehand. And also last week, it was already very slapdash. It's like nice. It was lovely.
This was nice to have like a full episode's worth of like content, like stuff happened.
Yeah. So you know, I'm gonna close my eyes.
I'm putting 9.
Yes. Get in.
If you give WTF 9, I'm gonna stab you.
No, absolutely. Yeah, no.
Then you're going too far.
No. Well, you take me through WTF because I think it's low.
I think it's low.
Aeneas ghosting, she getting angry, Virgil being...
Iarbas.
Yeah.
The gods meddling, that's pretty WTF. The being married without knowing you're married, that's quite a big WTF.
Yes, I think that is quite a messed up one, because like, it's more like, oh, you thought we were married.
Yeah. But him ghosting her was pretty funny.
Yeah, I think this is significant, actually. So I'm going to say... Maybe... But then again, there's suicide as well, and also... 5 or 6?
I think 5. I think it's pretty down the middle.
Yeah, it's down the middle. So that's fair, right?
Yeah, it's okay.
So we have 7, 9, 9, and 5. So that is...
A 30.
Right. Hold on. Yep, 30. Oh, it's just missed out there.
Yeah.
It's vying for top spot there.
It is. Close. But no cigar. Anything 30 and above is good.
Yeah. That was a good myth, though, wasn't it?
No, it was a good myth.
And what do you think of Dido? She's lovely.
I'm actually really sad about her. I liked her. Oh. I thought she was fit. is that inappropriate to say about a fictional dead character?
Oh, yeah. I'd take her to her cave, yeah. You know what I mean?
No, that was good, actually. I like it because it's going away from the Odyssey now.
Yeah, absolutely.
Last episode was very Odyssey-heavy. Like, it was basically the same journey.
It's doing its own thing now.
He's got his own characters and his own backstory.
I think that's probably my favourite part of the Aeneid. Yeah. And now we've got only got 8 more episodes left of things which are fine. So Dan, let's do some social media and then get the F out.
Last time we did it in 20 seconds. How long are we giving ourselves this time?
Do you want to do 10 seconds?
Ooh, that's going to be difficult.
Wait, before we do that, do see my Edinburgh Fringe show, because I really appreciate it. I didn't plug it last time, and I plugged it twice this time. So buy tickets online, it's only £5.
It's going to be really good.
And
I've seen a preview.
Yes, you saw the really early version of it, which now doesn't have many of those jokes anymore. But also, if you like Dido and like her doing a misery monologue about someone that you loved and now she's gone, come and see my show.
Nice.
Linking it in. Okay, should we do 10 seconds?
Yeah, go on.
Okay, should we take it in turns? Are we going to split it off halfway through? Or, you know, let's just vibe it.
Let's just vibe it.
Okay, 10 seconds, here we go. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Follow us on social media, Facebook and Twitter, at Miss Podcast, or join our Miffsters fan group. That's for people like yourselves who are fans. Or email us at miffs@gmail.com.
Awesome, Patreon and Kelfie right now. 10 seconds. Nice. Nice high. We have to high five at the end.
They know it. They know it anyway.
If you got this far and haven't sent us an email or donate to our podcast, well, firstly, that's fine because it's a free podcast. But also, you know what to do. Go to any other podcast and then just find out the details there. Oh, wait, this is... We're riffing on it now. Yeah, you know.
They know about the social media. They know who to email. They know how many stars to give us on iTunes. They know how to donate to our page.
Yes. So, Dan, it's time to...
Of course, this is the only episode you've ever tuned into.
Yeah, this is the first one.
Episode 74.
Then that's on you. That's not our fault.
Part 3 of the Aeneid. Part 4 of the Aeneid.
Dan, it's time to go now. Do you fancy doing a mosh pit in the cave? By which you mean, do you have sex in the cave?
Yeah, let's go.
Thank you very much. I've been Matt Hoss.
And I'm Dan Rhodes.
And
he's Matt Hoss.
And that's Dan Rhodes. And
I'm Dan Rhodes.
And I'm Matt Dan Rhodes Hoss.
Wait, which one am I?
Never mind. I've been. Sorry, I'm going to do it again. See you soon. Lots of love.
Bye.
Bye, Metallica's family.
Miffs. Miffs.